Bang, 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 bang. Hey, it's 3 o'clock in the morning. Don't bother me. I'm trying to dream pleasant dreams here. Bang, bang, bang. It's 1970. I'm a 20-year-old medical student in the north of England, and someone's banging on my door. God knows what hour. This continues, so I throw on a t-shirt, a pair of jeans, a pair of boots, rush down to the front door. Standing there is my buddy Ronan, next to a sparkling new motorcycle. He tosses me a motorcycle helmet, says, "Hey, we're out of here." 30 seconds later, we are indeed out of there. And 10 minutes later, according to the speedometer, we're doing 110 miles an hour up the Great North Road. At some point in the proceedings, Ronan turns to me and mumbles something that over the wind rushing by and the motorcycle helmet, I really cannot hear. So I give him a poke and say, "Speak up." So he slows down the bike momentarily and says, "Hey man, I'm tripping, you know, on acid," and then takes off again. So two things go through my head simultaneously. One is, hey, we're doomed. We'll be really lucky if we get out of this alive. And the second thing is, what's going on in his brain right now? And by what's going on in his brain, I don't mean the literal, what the hell was he thinking dragging me out of bed at 3 in the morning to take me on a motorcycle ride of death? But what's he seeing when he looks at the road? I mean, is he seeing tarmac flashing by like I am? Or is he seeing a bunch of fluorescent scorpions in a forest dancing the Macarena and singing Born to be Wild? So flash forward 50 years, actually 49 years, but who's counting? And currently, I'm a professor of psychiatry and neuroscience at Yale, and I'm the director of a research center that looks at brain imaging at the Institute of Living in Hartford. And one of the things that my group is studying at the moment is what's going on in the brains of intoxicated drivers. And one substance that we're particularly interested in is marijuana. So why do we think this is important? Well, according to the National Highway and Traffic Safety Administration, NHTSA, as more and more states are legalizing marijuana for recreational and medicinal purposes, more people are driving stoned on the roads. So this could be a public health problem, depending on how dangerous it is. And although many people have opinions, there are very few answers at the moment. So one thing my lab is trying to do is provide answers. So part of the problem with this is that the legal cart is way ahead of the scientific horse. So there are lots of laws to indict individuals who drive stoned, but very few of them, as I'll try and show you, are based on scientific fact. So a few caveats are in order. One is, I'm really not going to answer these questions for you this evening because the research hasn't caught up there, but I'll give you some inkling into the way we think about these problems and the way we're trying to solve them and address them. The second caveat is that I'm not here to offer anyone medical or legal advice. So, the third thing is I'm not here to give any free samples, as someone asked me earlier. So a question for you guys. Given that everyone has an opinion about stone drivers, raise your hand if you think driving under the influence of marijuana is a whole lot safer than driving under the influence of alcohol, that stone driving is no big thing. All right, so a bunch of you, mainly concentrated on this side of the room. So let me give you a thought experiment. You're on a plane, your seatbelt's buckled up, the jet engines are revving, and the cockpit door cracks open a little bit, and you can see the pilot and the co-pilot just for a second sparking up on a joint. How many of you would be worried about that? Raise your hand if you'd be, yeah, all right. So many of you are concerned about that, and that's not that different than driving stoned. So how does this work in the real world? So in the real world, police will likely pull you over for cause. And that can be anything from a busted taillight to you weaving while you're driving or driving erratically in some way. And the procedure usually is something like this. They'll ask you to step out of your car. They'll check your driver's license and insurance. And they'll give you a field sobriety test at the roadside. So a field sobriety test is usually things like, walk a straight line down the middle of the road while reciting the months of the year backwards. So if you are unsteady, then they will think that you're intoxicated. And roadside sobriety tests, such as that one, were developed for alcohol-impaired drivers with no thought that they would be used someday for marijuana-impaired drivers. And in fact, they're completely inappropriate because marijuana impairs different skills than alcohol. So the roadside tests that are given are not appropriate. So what happens next? If it appears that you're intoxicated in some way, the police will ask you to blow into a breathalyzer. And a breathalyzer is just a simple device that measures the concentration of alcohol in your breath, BAC, or breath alcohol concentration. And if that's positive and you blow over a certain limit, then you're arrested for drunken driving. But if you blow negative, yet you still seem to be impaired, the next step is the police will take you to a testing lab where someone will draw a blood sample, and they'll test your blood for various drugs, including metabolites of substances found in marijuana, the main one of which is tetrahydrocannabinol, or THC. Many of you have heard of THC. Now, the way things go in most states is that there are so-called per se laws. And per se is Latin for by itself. It's not named after someone called Percy, as one of my students asked me the other day. And the bottom line is, if any THC whatever shows up in your blood, per se, that's sufficient to result in a driving while intoxicated on marijuana charge. So there's a problem with that scientifically that I'll tell you about in just a second. So in other states, the law is slightly different, and that the THC level has to be above a certain very low limit for you to be convicted. But the basic idea is exactly the same. Is stone driving like drunk driving? How long does driving impairment last? And can driving impairment be validly tested at the roadside? So I told you about how roadside testing works. So let's dive into the science of what's going on in the background. So the situation with alcohol is very, very straightforward. Alcohol is fantastically water-soluble, which is why you can make cocktails just by shaking watery substances up with pure alcohol. And our bodies are 90% water. So when you take a couple of shots of liquor, for example, that immediately distributes evenly throughout your entire body. So the amount in your breath, which is water, your blood, which is mostly water, and your brain, unfortunately, most of which is water, is identical. So when you blow into a BAC meter, a breathalyzer, that's a very accurate interpretation of how much alcohol is on board. So many things follow from this scientifically. One is the more alcohol you take in, the higher your BAC. And because the amount in your brain is equivalent to the amount in your blood, the more alcohol you take in, the more impaired you are. And the third thing that follows from this and therefore the higher your crash risk. The other thing that follows from this is the more alcohol you take in, the higher your BAC and the longer it takes to come down. But it comes down over several hours, typically. So let's switch to THC. In marijuana, THC is not at all water-soluble. It's fantastically fat-soluble. So when you take a couple of bong hits, the amount of THC in your blood rises very rapidly, proportional to how much you took in, but then spikes down, because all of the THC is absorbed into your body fat. And it stays there at a very low level. And the problem is that it's gradually released back out of your body fat, literally over a matter of weeks. So if the police take you to a test lab and your blood is positive for THC, there's no way to tell whether that's because you smoked a joint 20 minutes ago or you smoked a joint 20 days ago. So this would be basically the equivalent of you going into a bar, drinking half a dozen beers, and 2 weeks later being pulled over by the police and indicted for drunken driving. So this doesn't make sense scientifically. So as we say in the trade, there's no BAC for THC because you can't measure THC on breath although several companies are developing devices that notionally may be able to do this one day. So how do we try and address these problems in my lab? Basically, we have bring in people, have them drive in virtual reality inside of an MRI scanner after we've given them different high or low or placebo doses of marijuana. So as you might expect, there's no shortage of volunteers. And we have them drive in high-end driving simulators. And we take throughout the day multiple blood and saliva samples to look for THC. So many of you are probably thinking, hey, driving flat on your back in an MRI scanner while someone takes pictures of your brain is absolutely not like driving on a real road in a real car. What do you guys think you're doing? So we have an answer for that question. So this is Virginia Tech's Smart Road in Blacksburg, Virginia. And it's 2 miles of realistic interstate, and beneath the surface of the tarmac are thousands of embedded sensors that communicate with sophisticated computer equipment in the trunk of cars on the road. And long story short, we've shown that individuals who drive intoxicated or sober on the Smart Road drive exactly the same and make the same errors as individuals driving in our driving simulators. So if you get someone intoxicated and they speed up on a corner on the Smart Road, they'll also speed up on the simulator and so on. So what have we gleaned from all of this? What's the ultimate bottom line? Well, stone driving isn't safe. But if you look at the odds of having an accident after being stoned, they're about double. And if you look at the odds of driving when you're intoxicated on alcohol, they're about 10 times that of driving sober at a BAC, a blood alcohol or breath alcohol concentration of 0.10. So although stone driving isn't safe, as many of you intuited, it seems to be less dangerous measure for measure than driving drunk. So this continues to be an important public policy issue, and one that we're trying to elucidate. But currently, there really is no BAC for THC, and roadside testing needs to be specifically adapted to cope with marijuana-impaired drivers. The other thing that I've tried to convince you of is just based on the persistence of THC in the blood over weeks or up to weeks, per se laws to me seem completely arbitrary and with no scientific foundation. They really should be done away with. So although we lack key data, there are things that we could do right now. And one thing that I might encourage you to do, if you feel like doing something about this, is to write to your local legislator and just urge for stoned driving laws to be based on science rather than based on arbitrary and capricious laws, not based on science as they are at the moment. So that's all I had to say. Thank you very much.